For 2021, the Gladiator is finally getting a diesel, and we've got the right one. It's a Rubicon. Let's go for a drive. I'm your host, Brian Max, racing driver and lover of driving fast, fun things. And on this channel, you get reviews for drivers from the driver's perspective. Now, this Gladiator Rubicon with the diesel is something hotly anticipated for 2021. And while I love driving these things off-road, there's a little bit of problem. My part of the world right now, all of these off-road trails are closed, so I'm doing the best I can with the roads that I'm aware of, so we're taking it on a soft roading adventure. But as we know from previous drives, this Gladiator Rubicon is very capable, but the diesel makes this a very different argument. The reason we're here is to test the diesel, and this is an all-new engine made in Cento, Italy, in Emilia-Romagna, which is known for Lambrusco and also being the birthplace of Ferruccio Lamborghini, but that's another story for another day. This is a 3-liter turbocharged V6 that makes 260 horsepower at 3,600 RPM and 442 pounds from 1,400 to 2,800 RPM. So I suspect it's the torque that's going to make this truck. With the diesel, there is only one transmission. It's the 8-speed automatic. There is the rock track transfer case, because Rubicon, of course, electronic locking front and rear diff, so yes, and the rear axle is a 373, in case you need to know. It's body on frame construction. It's a real truck, and it's got that much longer wheelbase than the Wrangler Unlimited. The suspension is a master design of solid axle technology, but the Rubicon gets these Fox shocks, which in my opinion makes the Rubicon. Brakes are four-wheel discs, and they're more than enough to suit the Gladiator. Gladiator Rubicon tires are meaty 33-inch Falcon Wild Peaks on 17-inch wheels. Curb weight of this thing is 5,350 pounds, which is notably 280 pounds more than the V6 Pentastar-powered Gladiator. Towing capacity, it's a reasonable 6,000 pounds. It's that time in the episode for how to spec your Gladiator Rubicon. In the US, the base price of a Gladiator Rubicon in 2021 is $43,875. In Canada, well, it's not zero. I don't have pricing right at this very minute. If I do have it, it'll be on the screen before this airs. About the diesel, well, it's $4,000 on top of the Pentastar. However, buried in the options list is the automatic transmission, which is mandatory. It's the only transmission that comes with the diesel engine, and that's an additional $2,000. So in total, that's $6,000 on top of a regular Gladiator to get the diesel, and that is a serious consideration. Otherwise, this is a modestly equipped tester. It's got the big Uconnect screen, which I love, and unfortunately, it's got leather seats, which I don't like. With that smattering of options as tested, this is $63,000 US before any freight delivery and local taxes. In Canada, well, again, it's not zero. I just don't have the pricing. If I do, it'll be here on the screen for you to enjoy. Now, how do you spec yours? Well, if you want some speed and some grunt and some acceleration out of your Gladiator, you have to get the diesel. It's got so much more performance than the Pentastar V6. You kind of got to get it. Those are the things I value, so that's what I would do with my Gladiator. That said, how do you spec the rest of it? Well, I've got a strong opinion here, and I don't know if everybody will agree, but that doesn't matter. If you're getting a Gladiator, you need to get it in a Rubicon or Mojave trim, and that's because why wouldn't you want to be able to take this everywhere a Gladiator is capable of going? Anywhere you want, off-road, on-road, whatever. A Mojave or a Rubicon literally does everything and it goes everywhere.
Seating position in a Gladiator Rubicon or even a Wrangler Rubicon is very much the same. Short guys like me have to climb up into these things, but once you're here, you've got excellent visibility. The seating position is kind of vertical. You do sit high, but that's for good reason. You want that high seating position so you can see over the hood when you're off-roading. That's very important. But the rest of the cockpit is laid out pretty well. The steering wheel is, I've got fully extended, and I'd love just to get a little closer to the wheel. I'd like a little more reach out of this steering wheel, but otherwise the position is just fine. And for our purposes of a little soft roading and a little tiny bit of off-roading, the seating position is quite excellent. And on the freeway, of course, seating position is quite all right. You can see everything and the seat is very comfortable and very supportive and a little flat. It's certainly not a bolstered seat like you find in a sports car, but that's not what we're driving here. We're driving an off-roader. My only complaint with seating position is that there's not a dedicated dead pedal for my left foot, and that's especially helpful when you're doing some serious off-roading. I'd like something there. My guess is that there is an aftermarket solution. I haven't looked for one. Ergonomically, everything is familiar and modern Jeep, and with Jeep Iconics interior design, everybody loves this stuff, it seems, and it's, you know, fun having the window controls here so that you can take the doors off, which we're not going to do because it is a blistering 105 Fahrenheit outside, so we're going to keep the air conditioning on. This does have cameras front and rear, and it does have parking sensors, of course, and I find that kind of funny with a Rubicon trim Gladiator because it's got the big steel bumpers, and you know, if you wanted to, you can just drive those big steel bumpers into anything you want and not leave a mark on your Gladiator. The second row is not too bad either. I've actually sat back there and it's spacious and comfortable enough for those second row, second class citizens you might be taking with you. There's not much to say about the infotainment system. This is the big screen Uconnect, and it works great on its own, and of course has Apple CarPlay and Android Auto. And if you're a fan of the channel, you know I love Apple CarPlay and pretty much live by it. So it is redeemed by that. But otherwise, as a standalone system, this is one of the best in the business. Now we're here to talk about this diesel, and this is an entirely different engine than the Pentastar. The Pentastar is fine, and in the Gladiator it might feel strained from time to time, but here, oh, I just love this diesel, and it's that big, fat, broad torque curve that helps this Gladiator do what it needs to do. Sure, off-roading, what we're doing now, doesn't really matter, but in the real world, in day-to-day driving, this diesel engine, this EcoDiesel, is fantastic. There's just that abundance of torque from just off idle well into the rev range, and this thing will get up and scoot. It will accelerate onto the freeway, no trouble at all, and has no problem keeping up with traffic at any speed. And the thing about this diesel, it's kind of the best of all worlds. Sure, you can crawl around off-road, no problem, and that's, you know, no problem for the Pentastar either, but it's in day-to-day driving where this diesel makes all the difference because it's got so much more performance. This has so much more acceleration over the Pentastar. It's a joy to drive on a day-to-day basis. No problem accelerating, no problem getting up to highway speed. It is just fantastic. There's just not a lot of clatter from this engine either. So it's very quiet, very comfortable. Yeah, there's a bit of wind noise and a bit of road noise, especially in Rubicon trim, but there's not much noise from this engine, making it very, very easy to live with. And then when you need some power, well, just lean into the throttle and here we go. As a diesel, it responds reasonably well. It's not a sharp, crisp, naturally aspirated petrol engine. You know, it is a turbo diesel and it does respond promptly. And as you'd expect from a diesel, there's not lag, but it's just a little slower to respond. And that's what you should expect with a diesel, of course. The 8-speed transmission is a great match for this engine as well. They've calibrated right, the gear selections are right, and it just works brilliantly. Manual transfer case is the same old thing, but there's nothing wrong with it. It's a heavy duty piece, of course, to deal with this Rubicon with the big diesel, and it's easy to shift as I've done climbing up this little hill. off-road handling is where the Rubicon shines. No problem crawling over anything. Tons of ground clearance, and it's got bash guards and rock rails all over the place. So if you do get serious about off-roading, there's no problem in Rubicon trim. It is fantastic in that regard. And if you get serious, you've got locking diffs down here, and you can disconnect the front sway bar. Isn't that fantastic? Also, if you're going off-roading, rather than leaving your key in your pocket or whatever, there's a spot for it right here. Check this out. It's perfect. You just leave it there, go off-roading, have a great time. And Jeep's thought of a lot of useful functions and features that are all throughout this Gladiator that we're not going to get into here. I'm sure I've covered it before, but there's a lot of extra thought that's gone into the usability of this Gladiator. Steering is very much Gladiator. It is perfect for off-road, not perfect for driving on a racetrack, and we know that the steering ratio is a bit on the slow side, and that's great for off-roading and crawling on some sketchy stuff that we're driving on right now. Brake feel and control is excellent for something like a Gladiator. There's good feel out of the brake pedal, and you really can control the attitude in an emergency or under heavy braking, and because I have been driving in Southern California traffic, there's been a lot of that as well. But I do enjoy the brakes here. They offer a tremendous amount of control, and someone who likes a positive brake pedal, well, I'm very happy here. With the off-road tuning of the suspension, on the road, there is a lot of dive under braking and a lot of body roll in the corners, but that's just to remind you that you are driving a serious off-roader, and it makes no bones about that. Again, it's not a sports car because it is tuned for off-roading with all of that ground clearance and all of its off-road prowess. Well, that is the compromise. I've driven it on the freeway, on city streets, and here a little bit off-roading, and the suspension is calibrated wonderfully for all of those conditions, and you know, it's relatively comfortable on the road as well, and it's certainly comfortable on this very rough road that I'm driving on right now. And certainly the longer wheelbase of the Gladiator helps out tremendously.
My verdict? Well, this is an interesting one, and we're here to test the diesel. Fuel consumption is remarkable. No matter what I'm doing, where I'm driving, how I'm driving, I get 23 miles per gallon. That's it, 23 miles per gallon. No better, no worse. 23 miles per gallon, and I'm really impressed with that, especially given the performance of this package. That diesel really makes this Gladiator, and that's why we're here. We're here to test this diesel engine, and I think over the course of my test with it, it has proven itself, and not just as an engine, but as a complete package. If you're going to get a Gladiator in 2021, spend the extra money, get the EcoDiesel. This is a brilliant package.
Thanks for hanging out with me today and having a look at this 2021 Jeep Gladiator Rubicon with the wonderful EcoDiesel V6. Hope you liked this piece, and if you did, well, you are not new to YouTube. You know what to do. Smash the subscribe button, turn on your notifications, like this, of course, and if you liked it, please share it with your friends, and if there's any ask we have, that's to share this on Reddit. Appreciate if you do that. Thanks in advance for that. If you have any questions or comments, please leave them in the comments below, and I'll get back to you as soon as I can. If you want to support the channel, well, hit up our merch store. Links here, links below, and you can get lots of cool stuff for car enthusiasts like us. And if you live in a place where you have to wear masks like I do, well, you can get a cool Save the Manuals mask. I know this is not a manual, but a lot of us drive manual transmissions at home, don't we? So you can get one of those Save the Manuals masks and show your allegiance to the manual transmission. Thanks again for watching. We'll see you again next time.